Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I'm Dr. Anita Bhela from the University of Delhi. And today we are going to do the module which deals with Lionel Trilling and Freud as literary critics. This module is to be read in conjunction with the module on Freud and literature. This module will be presenting Trilling and Freud as critics of literary arts, with special reference to Lionel Trilling's The Ribbler Imagination. This module will also look at the background to Freud and literature. Lionel Trilling lived from 1905 to 1975, was an American literary critic. He married Diana Rubin in 1929, and both Trilling and Diana Rubin were members of the New York Intellectuals. Trilling's important works include The Liberal Imagination, written in 1950, and considered perhaps his major contribution to criticism, Freud and the Crisis of Our Culture, The Opposing Self, written in 1955, Beyond Culture, written in 1965, Mind in the Modern World, written in 1972, Sincerity and Authenticity in 1972. Trilling was a self-claimed liberal or democratic socialist. He defines the task of a critic for us. He says, "The job of criticism would seem to be then to recall liberalism to its first essential imagination of variousness and possibility, which implies the awareness of complexity and difficulty. To the carrying out of the job of criticizing the liberal imagination, literature has a unique relevance, not merely because so much of modern literature has explicitly directed itself upon politics, but more importantly, because literature is the human activity that takes the fullest and most precise account of variousness, possibility, complexity, and difficulty." Trilling belongs, along with Edmund Wilson, to the culture, to the critics of culture, in particular American culture. He's often concerned about questions of pedagogy, questions of psychology and self-definition, which are only remotely related to literature. Politically, Trilling preserved his liberalism. Here it rather refers not to the general idea of socialism, but here it refers to the belief in progress, in humanitarianism, in human and civil rights, in equality for the Negro, and of course the Jew, still discriminated against in the academy. Trilling loved to read Jane Austen, Henry James, and E.M. Forster because they represented the culture of creativity. He says that he sees literary situations as cultural situations, and cultural situations as great elaborate fights about moral issues, and moral issues have something to do with literary style. He feels free to begin with for what for him is the first concern, that is the animus of the author, the objects of his will, the things he wants or wants to have happen. Three aspects of Lionel Trilling as a critic. He observes the representation of self in the literary works. He observes the representation of characters in their society. And he also observes the ethics of the author's formulation of the literary arts. As said earlier, Trilling was a liberal Democrat, and he read literature from the sociological, psychological, and ethical points of view. he felt that these three points of view exposed the strength of literature. He thought that man revolves around the entities of the self, the society, and of morality, and that literature is the best means of exposition of these three entities. That is why he observes literature as an exposition of the cosmopolitan self, the society, and morality, and he considers literature as cosmopolitan writing. He says the characters in literature, Shakespeare's Hamlet or Iago or Osborne's Jimmy or Conrad's Marlowe and Coates, of course, are characters in literature, but they are also representatives of our psyche. They all represent something of our psyche, something of our own mind, something of our thoughts. And therefore, they become permanent scepters that seem to be controlling our mind. And that is the reason why a Hamlet or a Iago is still popular. Why? Because they are part of our psyche. Characters in literature represent our psyche. Literature is an ever-existing, ever-living phenomenon. For reading literature, one should have multiple perspectives. A peculiar perspective or obsession with a particular point of view of a reader will fetch him nothing from the reading of literature, but simply as a narration of a story related to a piece of publication, nothing more. So the reader should avoid bringing any preconceived notions or ideas or points of view to the reading of literature if he or she wants to gain maximum from the reading of literature. Trilling tries to look for a link between the political ideas of the educated class and the deep places of the imagination in literature. His concept of the liberal imagination exemplifies this link. In his own words, in literature, as in our personal lives, there seems to be a debate between the heroic and the anti-heroic principle world. Natural rhythm of the psyche, an alternation of commitment to the superego, which is the repository of our governing ideals, and to the id, which is the focus of our instinctual drives. It's important to understand the concept of id, ego, and superego taken from Freud. The id is the unconscious, and it is based on the pleasure principle, and it has its desires and it wants them fulfilled. The superego is that which tries to see the acceptance of those desires by society, by what is considered moral and what is considered good or bad by the self. The ego tries to create a balance between the superego and the id by finding some rational ways of fulfilling the desires of id without having to go against social norms and moral norms of society. Lionel Trilling, as a critic, tries to always concentrate on what role the writer is going to play, and he always concerns himself with the responsibility of the author. Sigmund Freud has been a great influence at the time in the 19th century when he was born and he formulated his ideas or propagated the psychoanalytic theory. His ideas are still popular even today, although people do not agree with much that he said. Lived from 1856 to 1939. He was himself a medical neurologist, a medical scholar, who had also studied philosophy and other disciplines. And he always tried to understand the causes of human activities and the forces behind those activities. He came up with a number of theories, the theory of instinct and the theory of dreams. His theory of dreams is well known. And he also came out with the theory of the mind and the theory of sex. In his theory of dreams, he tells us how dreams are in a way a means by which the self fulfills desires. Although they may come in different distorted forms, but the origin of these dreams is the repressed desires of the individual. He also coined many words like the Oedipus complex, the Electra complex, slip of the tongue, pen, and above all, the concept of defense mechanisms. The results of reading works are the... Because of all his intellectual attempts and experimentations, Freud is regarded as the father of psychoanalysis. In fact, he treated his patients, especially neurotic patients, by asking them to discuss everything that had happened to them and try to find causes of what could have resulted in their neurosis. He would sit with his patients patiently in the room and talk to them about their problems and then prescribe his medications. He spread and promoted psychoanalysis as medical experiment and psychoanalysis related to literary criticism. And he established schools, societies, and forums for promoting his science. Freud's ideas may be commonplace today, but he was the progenitor of many ideas with which today we may agree or disagree, but they have become a part of our psyche. Talked about ideas relating to human feelings, human emotions, and human conduct. And even those critics who do not agree with either his psychoanalytical experimentation or his psychoanalytical theory of the mind, yet they borrow many phrases taken from Freud, such as repression and narcissism. And also we very often use the term Oedipus complex in interpreting literary works or in understanding human behavior. Let us take a look at Freud's theory of dreams. Freud introduces Eros as a productive energy, and he conceptualizes the theory of dreams and repression in Beyond the, and he expresses many of his ideas in Beyond the Pleasure Principle. He introduces what is called Thanatos as destructive energy, and which is called the principle of psychic inertia. Many of his essays discuss psychoanalysis as therapy. Some of these essays are Project for a Scientific Psychology, The Etiology of Hysteria, On Dreams, Three Essays on the Theory of Sexuality, Family Romances, Notes Upon a Case of Obsessional Neurosis, and From the History of an Infantile Neurosis. We have just been told in brief about the id, ego, and superego. We'll go into it in a little bit of detail. Freud proposed that the human psyche could be divided into three parts, that is the id, ego, and superego. Freud discussed this model in the 1920 essay Beyond the Pleasure Principle and fully elaborated upon it in The Ego and the Id, written in 1923. Here he developed it as an alternative to his previous topographic schema, that is the conscious, the unconscious, and the preconscious. The id, is the completely unconscious, impulsive, childlike portion of the psyche that operates on the pleasure principle. It is the source of our basic impulses and drives, and it seeks immediate pleasure and gratification. Freud acknowledged that his use of the term id was not his own, and that the superego is the moral component of the psyche, which takes into account no special circumstances in which the morally right thing may not be right for a given situation. The rational ego attempts to create a balance between the impractical hedonism of the id, hedonism meaning the indulgence in the pleasures, and the equally impractical moralism of the superego. That is, the id and the superego sometimes are in conflict. Therefore, it is a part of the psyche that is usually reflected most directly in a person's action through the action of the ego. But what happens when there is too much repression, when overburdened or threatened by its task? It may employ defense mechanisms, including denial, repression, undoing, rationalization, and displacement. This concept is usually represented by the iceberg model. The iceberg model represents the roles of the id, ego, and superego, and the manner in which they relate to conscious and unconscious thought. In Beyond the Pleasure Principle, Freud compared the relationship, as one can say, between the ego and the id to a charioteer and the horses that drive the chariot. The horses are the symbols that provide the energy and drive. On the other hand, the charioteer is that which provides direction, that is the ego. What about Freud as a literary critic? As a literary critic, Freud has expressed his views in his essays entitled Obsessive Actions and Religious Practices, Creative Writers and Daydreaming, Leonardo da Vinci and a Memory of His Childhood, Totem and Taboo, The Theme of the Three Caskets, The Moses of Michelangelo, and Contribution to a Questionnaire on Reading. These essays are further discussed with reference to his other essays on narcissism, An Introduction, Instincts and Their Vicissitudes, Repression, the Unconscious, and Mourning and Melancholia. Freud felt that literature was a means of fulfilling the unfulfilled desires of the mind. And it was not only for the reader, but for the creator of literature as well. Therefore, the creator was as neurotic as the reader. His views on religion. Religious faith is also a defense mechanism. He applied the principles of psychoanalysis to theology and personal faiths. Religion, according to him, is a veil to truth because it is three times distortingly presented based on three views. Religious concepts are transmitted in three ways and thereby claim our belief. Firstly, because our primal ancestors already believed them. Secondly, because we possess proofs which have been handed down to us from antiquity. And thirdly, because it is forbidden to raise the question of their authenticity at all. He also thinks, as I said earlier, that literary artists are daydreamers, and literature is a way of fulfilling the writer's own repression. He tries to explain through the understanding of Oedipus complex in Oedipus Rex and gives the example of Hamlet, that is, the repressed impulses of Hamlet. Hamlet seems to be suffering from the Oedipus complex. Freud felt that psychoanalysis could equate pure medical sciences. He talks about female sexuality and the passive nature of the female. Freud was a versatile genius, so to say, because he did not confine himself only to the suffering of men and women that he treated. He tried to apply his principles of the psychoanalytic theory to virtually all disciplines, to mythology, religion, politics, culture, education, law, and even prehistory. Lionel Trilling's essay, Freud and Literature, was first published in J.C. Ransom's edited journal, The Keynesian Review, in 1940. Then it was republished in Horizon in 1947. And then it was collected in Trilling's book, The Liberal Imagination, Essays on Literature and Society, which were published in 1950. Freud and Literature and Freud and Romanticism. Freud felt that although the practices of Romanticism and psychoanalysis were different, yet they had much that was identical to them. For Trilling, much of Freud's postulations are the result of his having read the Romantics and the Romantic literature, and that they influenced him, The subject of both the theory rests on perceptions received by him. Freud and Literature also informs us that an author's intention or motive cannot tell about everything related to his art. That is, we must look to other things as well. Trilling's psychological perspective to the literary art inspired him to trace psychological principles of life in literature that existed even before Freud formulated his theories. In his Freud and Literature, Lionel Trilling criticizes extremist perspectives to literary arts and conceptualizes the theory of the liberal imagination as a creative force to reading and writing literature. Let us sum up. Today we have studied about Lionel Trilling as a literary critic, and we have also studied Freud's psychoanalysis and his theories of understanding the psyche. Freud, we know, was a medical neurologist. And he tried to understand the sufferings of his patients and tried to ameliorate their suffering through psychoanalysis. However, he tried to apply his psychoanalytical theories to almost all disciplines, even to literature and religion. He propounded his theory of the id, the ego, and the superego, which deal with the concept of the repressed desires, the norms of morality and society, and how the individual tries to create a balance, and that is done by the ego. Freud went so far as to say that all literature is an expression of those unfulfilled, repressed desires of the artist. And the reader finds fulfillment of his or her own repressed desires through the reading of literature. He also said that religion was also a way of trying to fulfill or those desires, and that it had no value in itself. Lionel Trilling, as a critic, tries to understand Freud and comes to the conclusion that all extremist tendencies towards understanding should be eschewed, and he pleads for the cause of the liberal imagination in this regard. For more information, go to the e-text. Thank you.